Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for being on this week's Writers on Writers over a Triple Espresso podcast with your host, Patrick Greenwood. I cannot begin to tell you how happy you are to have Jim Flynn back for our third time. We've had him on this wonderful podcast. Jim, good morning. How are you today?
Well, I remember when you were kind of a Cub Scout at doing this. Now you're a big deal. You know, you're kind of the Kim Kardashian of bicycle writing novelists who are award-winning podcasters. I know that kind of narrows down the field, but you've come a long way, man.
Well, thank you. And you know, you were actually one of my very first guests that I had on the podcast when I started a year ago. And I got to tell you, it's always great to follow you. I follow all your books. I cannot begin to, you know, stop laughing when I'm reading your books. You've got tremendous humor. But I got to tell you, when I did have a chance to read the 10 greatest golfers of all time, and of course, I didn't make the list, which is a little disappointing. We'll get into that on another podcast later. But I have to tell you, I had a chance to read it. I enjoyed it. I think one of the things that's really fun about reading a Jim Flynn book, especially the golf ones as well, is that it's really a pocketbook. You can give it for a Father's Day present coming up this, obviously next, not this Sunday, but the following Sunday is Father's Day. Highly recommend that people take a look at this book. But I have to tell you, I don't agree with your top 10 list.
a lot of people don't. And I actually used the Matrix. I put together a, you know, I'm not the IT guy that you are, but I put together an Excel spreadsheet and I weighted certain factors and I used Sports Illustrated and Golf Digest and I had chat bots generate all kinds of lists based on criteria. And that's the list that I used.
So I don't want to give away too much because I want people to read the book. I want people to pick it up on Amazon as well and pick it up on your website. But let's start talking a little bit about, you made a really kind of very strong notion early on in the book about research. And how you went back and researched all the golfers that made the list as well. When you were researching the Ben Hogans and obviously, you know, the Bobby Jones of the world, the Tiger Woods, the Jack Nicklaus of the world, you know, all the way up, even the Gary Players of the world, what did you find interesting about researching? Was it stuff you already knew or did you kind of scratch your head going, I did not know that. I didn't know that about Byron Nelson or any of the other.
Well, Byron Nelson is a really good example because I didn't know anything about Byron Nelson. I knew he was an old guy. I saw him on TV. I knew he was a great golfer, but I didn't know his personality at all. That was the fun part. And what I say, people say, describe this book, it's 10 guys. It does, instead of, you have to have some statistics so you can compare one to another and why did this guy make it and somebody else not make it. But mostly it's a roughly 2,000 word essay on their person, on a personal glimpse into the into the guy. Byron Nelson's a perfect example. He was Mr. Rogers. He was a genuinely very nice man. And everybody said that about him, except for Ben Hogan, who said he had a great swing, but that's Ben Hogan for you. But learning about Byron Nelson, for example, or Walter Hagen, I didn't, you know, I have a Walter Hagen golf shirt. That's how much I knew about Walter Hagen. And he's a really interesting guy. You could do a pretty interesting book on Walter Hagen and lots of people have, but you could do a movie on Walter. Walter Hagen was a rock star.
Yeah, for his time.
Yeah, he was as famous as Babe Ruth back in the 1920s. And because of his colorful life, there's a million anecdotes on him. Now, Byron Nelson did not show up at the first tee and have a waiter bring him a martini and drink the martini while his opponent was getting the tee off, which is something that Walter Hagen did. You know, Byron Nelson never did anything like that. So, but that's what makes it interesting because the characters are very different. Sam Snead is really different from Arnold Palmer.
Oh no, by far. And I think that when you start, talking about comparing, you know, like an example of Tiger Woods to an Arnold Palmer and they both kind of had their thing in life. But one of the interesting things I loved about the book was obviously your level of detail that you provided. But the one thing I noticed that I really wanted to ask you is why did people like Don January or Nancy Lopez not make the book?
Nancy's a woman. So Nancy's a woman. And the first paragraph says top 10 male golfers of all time.
Right. So is that something that are you planning considering as you've done the
men? I don't know.
Is there a way of doing the top 10 women?
It's funny. My son, Eric, says, you got to branch away from golf. I said, well, how about the five hottest Treasury secretaries of all time.
They don't exist. They're all ugly.
Chapter one, Janet Yellen. You know, I don't know if I have enough to mine there. I've thought about, you know, what's the next project going to be? When you're your own boss, you can invent your next project. And I'm working on two of them at now. But that's something I thought about. I don't know if there'd be an audience for 10 women. Anyhow, I love Nancy Lopez. She's not a man. That's why she's not on it. Don January didn't win anywhere near enough majors to be considered.
Yeah, but he did have nice golf clubs. I think my very first golf set I had was a Don January set that my father bought me when I was 7. And it actually worked really well. And I mean, that's what I remember Don January was. He came close that one year where he may have won the Hawaiian Open, where he came close and he blew it in the end. But he did have really nice golf clubs, though. That was kind of a nice.
Well, you know, there's a lot of Don Januaries around. Mm-hmm. And I think that might make an even more interesting book. Mm-hmm. To go into Don January's and the guy who ate the buffalo, I can't think of his name, but kind of next tier down. And because golfers are colorful characters.
Oh, God.
You know, because golf is an individual sport and you had to kind of pay your own way. And there are kind of trust fund boys who did it, but there's also guys who are living in their car. And so I think that might be, if I go to another golf book, I haven't decided. I might not do sports at all anymore. Mm-hmm. I'm doing two other books that don't have anything to do with golf. Mm-hmm. I'm always working on two books.
Well, I got to tell you, you bring up colorful characters. When I think it was in 2000, maybe in 2008 or 2009 at Torrey Pines in San Diego, where, you know, I got a ticket to go see that Friday round. And I was doing it more to try to see Tiger Woods and see the entire Messiah people following him. But I got to tell you, I had the biggest crack of watching John Daly tee off. You know, he had his cigarettes, he had his Diet Coke, he had his like Hooters bag, and he had the like colorful tigers on his thing, whatever. But I got to tell you, he was, for people that have read about him, they see him on Sports Illustrated or they see him on television. When you see him live, I know now he's much different than he was, you know, 15 years ago, but he was one that you would go, okay, that was worth waiting in line to see him tee off, because he was a personality. He still is a personality in itself.
Well, I'm guessing you don't have bears in your yard, but in Colebrook, Connecticut, we occasionally have a bear walk through our backyard. And once in a while, it's a big boy. And they say, oh, don't be afraid. They don't attack anybody. It could definitely kill you if it wanted to.
Yes.
And so seeing a bear is kind of like, it's kind of like seeing John Daly. I'm sure John Daly's a little startling to see. And yeah, there are some colorful characters like that. And there might be some things to mine in the John Daly's of the world, in the Don January's and Mo, what's guy Mo? I can't think of his last name. A really crazy guy used to tee off with, you know, he'd have holes where he'd tee off with an 8-iron, then hit a driver from the fairway and, you know, Mo Norman, his name was, and he used to carry all his money in his pocket. If he had $50,000, he'd have it in his front pocket. Mm-hmm. So there are guys like that. We may mine that field.
Okay. Well, I do appreciate, by the way, that you left Fuzzy Zeller off the list, because I'm not a Fuzzy fan at all. I think he's a, you know, he doesn't even belong on a course. But I do appreciate the fact that my favorite golfer of all time, which is Bobby Jones, made your list. I wish it was a little higher, though, than where he landed. But he was one that I've always, you know, read about, not only from what he did for golf, but just kind of what he did in general in life. You know, he was definitely one of those guys. But was there anybody else that you can think about that was on the fence between 10 and 11 that you said, you know what, there's just not enough metrics there to have that person there?
Who was Gene Sarazen is the guy who came the closest.
And he was number 11.
He's the only guy who won the career Grand Slam who's not in the top 10. He didn't win that many other tournaments. He didn't play that long. It's hard to kick other guys off to put him on.
Mm-hmm. So which golfer in the top 10 that made your book, that, again, I don't want to disclose too much because I want people to read your.
Well, we pretty much talked about all of them so far.
So far, we're staying off of it, but. Who was the biggest a-hole in the top 10? Who would you say
Sam Snead, the leader in the clubhouse. What made him that? At the end of the book, I say, you know, if I had a time machine, here's who I'd go visit. Mm-hmm. And I say, I wouldn't want to spend 5 seconds with Sam Snead.
Was he that, I mean, was he that big of a, you know, kind of a.
I actually kind of cleaned it up.
Okay.
He was worse than I said he was, and I won't go into, you know, racial and stuff like that. He wasn't a good guy.
Who was the best guy? Who was the genuine
Arnie,
other?
Arnie.
You think Arnie was the best out of all? I mean, just
In terms of
personality.
being a guy,
Right.
yeah.
What made him that?
Well, he was humble, and you know, as I explain in the book, if you want to know him, just look at his autograph. If you get an autograph, and I've had people call me and say, "Hey, I met Arnold Palmer. I have his autograph. They sent me a picture." You're absolutely right. Every autograph he wrote, you could read it. It said Arnold Palmer. You didn't have to. I think this might be Fuzzy's, or it's you know, Paige Spironak. I can't tell who wrote it. That to me, that summed up the guy. You were important to him. You might have been some dweeb who was there at the Greater Hartford Open. He showed you were important for 5 seconds while he looked you in the eye and signed your autograph. And the other thing about Arnie, and I tell this story in there too, he would have a press conference. Tiger and Jack, when you know they're done at 12:48, they're out of there at 12:48. They have their security take them out. Arnie used to go into the writers and say, "Do you have enough for your story? Need any more?" You know, some guy from a little podunk newspaper, he'd help him. That was genuine. That wasn't something that he learned from a press agent. He was genuinely that kind of guy. And I know people who met him and they felt like they met Arnold Palmer. And, you know, they just got his autograph and he talked to him for a minute. So, to me, he's hands down the best guy.
I would agree, because I know also one of the things that a lot of people don't realize is that Arnold Palmer really helped redefine how to do sponsorships and how to do endorsements and how to make a really good living. And he was doing what Pennzoil, he's doing all sorts of other,
Oh, he
you
had 100 companies he endorsed. And one of the, you know, again, I'm not going to read your whole book, but Arnie owned four dealerships and at the same time was doing national endorsement for Cadillac. Who else could get away with that? Nobody else could
Well,
get away
that's
with
it.
that.
It took him to that. So you mentioned you kind of led in a little bit about talking about some other writing projects. I know that golf is obviously golf, and of course, I follow also your other book when you do your fictional stuff as well. But talk a little bit about what you're working on now. You got two books in the hopper. What are they coming out? What sort of the storylines you're working on?
Well, I'm doing the fourth J.R. Johnson book. I finished it and I wasn't happy with it. And I don't know if you have this experience, but it doesn't get easier. It gets harder to write novels because you expect more from yourself. I want this to be better than the last one. So I wasn't happy with it. It wasn't good enough. So I didn't want to just put it out because there's some people who are really big fans of JR. And when's their next book coming out? It's not like there's millions of people emailing me, but there are some people. What, you know, when's the next? I said, when it's ready, it'll come out when it's ready. So I hired a developmental editor who's different than a beta reader. The people, listeners don't know, a beta reader is somebody you give your draft to and they read it and they might make suggestions based on content. Not so much, they're not a proofreader. They say, you know, it doesn't make sense that he would, you know, go out with this girl and, you know, the stuff like that. But a developmental editor is somebody you pay, and you pay pretty good dollars for it.
Of course.
I basically used the money I made on the first golf book to pay for some of this stuff. You know, fortunately, I'm retired and I can eat and play golf and stuff. So I took the money I made. I made some pretty decent money from the first golf book, and I used it for stuff like developmental editors. And I hired this woman. The key is don't hire your friend. Friends can say it's great, and you have to hire somebody who's objective, and you don't want so you don't want somebody who's really tells you how much you stink. You want somebody kind of in the middle. And anyhow, this woman was an editor for a couple big publishers, and she came back to me and made a very good suggestion. And I won't go all writery on people, but it has to do with point of view characters, and so I'm basically rewriting the whole book, and I think it's really good. Of course, it's hard to judge your own stuff, And I'm going to resubmit it to this editor when I'm done. But it's a little bit different. JR is the narrator of the book, but there's some other point of view character. It's different. And I don't want to get all writery and plot structure and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. But, one of the things I'm doing this for is to learn. I might be old. I'm doing it to learn and grow as a person. And mm-hmm. I really feel that I'm doing that with this JR book. Now, the other book that I used AI to do the outline for this book.
Mm-hmm.
And we talked a little bit off air. We talked a lot off air on AI. AI is great for that. Give me an outline of this.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the unethical people just have AI write the book.
The whole thing. And then they still put their name on it.
Put their name on it. And you can pretty much tell. Mm-hmm. It's going to get better, but you can pretty much tell. Now, I don't do that. But if it writes something, I'll take it and I'll either rewrite it or use it as an idea or something like that. And anyhow, the name of the working title of the book is The Power of Optimism.
Mm-hmm.
Now, people think, oh, this guy's really cynical and he's funny. And what is this little Miss Sunshine? No, but I am an optimist.
Mm-hmm.
And I start off the book, as I told you, a true story. I was laying on a bed in the emergency room in Vermont at this little hospital, and I woke up and there's a guy shining a light in my eyes saying, James, do you know where you are? And I said, no. And people don't call me James too often. I thought maybe I was under arrest or something.
you were handcuffed to the bed.
I wasn't handcuffed. That was a good sign. So the short version, he says, you have a broken arm, broken vertebrae, you bit off part of your tongue, some other stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
It was caused because you fell off the golf cart, which was caused because you had a seizure. And he had a seizure because you had an undiagnosed brain tumor. Here it is up here in the picture. Mm-hmm. And I said to him, this is true. I said, yeah, but other than that, how am I doing?
Now, was the brain tumor the size of a golf ball? Or is this
No, it wasn't that big, but it was big enough to make me fall off the golf cart.
Okay.
And I had just had my annual physical 3 days before and passed flying colors. So they don't always find everything. Right? So, so the cynical Jim Flynn, who writes these, books, I'm at heart an optimist. And so I started doing research on optimism. And that was kind of in the back burner for a long time. But then it was a lot easier to research optimism. So I started to do that. I'm writing the book myself, but and we might differ a little bit on what we think about the future of AI is. It's great for research. It's not always right. Sometimes it tells you things are wrong.
Yes.
But point me in this direction. I'll give you a great example about Byron Nelson. Going back to the golf book. I didn't know anything about Byron Nelson. So I started to learn about him. And he was called Lord Byron. A sports writer in Texas came up with the nickname Lord Byron after the poet. And it caught on. It's a catchy name. And he was dominating golf at the time. And people liked the name Lord Byron. So I wrote in, as you can, this conversational AI. Did Byron Nelson like the nickname Lord Byron? It spit back 5 pages, part of his autobiography. He never liked the name. He was too humble. He did not like the name. So that gave me more ideas to research from. It gave me enough information. It would have taken me 3 months in libraries to find out what I found out in 2 minutes if I ever would have found this stuff.
Well, that's the power of the AI. Is that when we talked earlier about AI and its value, to me, the fact that you have petabytes of data that's sitting out there, many of it is unstructured. AI is a great way to be able to say, look, here's what I'm looking for. Here's where I want to go with what I'm doing. Give me the context of what would be doing. And then after I write something, how is this competitively against other people's writings? And more importantly, is my content still original, right? If people keep AI in that context, it has tremendous value in our industry. It's the people that say, write me the book, write me the blog, write me the ebook, whatever, and I'm still going to throw my name on it. Well, there's no protection for what you just wrote because it isn't yours. It's public domain knowledge now, and anybody else can stifle it and do whatever they want with it. But I think that to your point is that without having AI, you would have spent months manually going through searches and Bing and all the other search engines and Google and everything else. And you would have had to still do a manual correlation of that where the AI kind of gave you that 5 pages for you to get the ideas necessary to keep your writing going.
Right. And now I'm doing this thing on optimism. And I said, give me someone who had no reason to be an optimist, who was optimistic and it worked out for them. Or some, you know, you just conversationally ask it. Mm-hmm. Helen Keller. How's that for an optimist? She achieved what she, and I never would have come up with Helen Keller on my own. Right. Mm-hmm. She was optimistic. That's why she achieved all the things that she did. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you can think of somebody with more problems than that, let me know. and she, you know, she was invited to lunch at the White House. I'm still waiting for my call. You know,
I'm sure it's coming after this.
Yeah. I mean, look at all the things she accomplished. So there's somebody who's optimistic, and she threw her, what do you call it, interpreter or helper, Ann Sullivan, wrote books. And one of the books she wrote is how being optimistic helped her. She, you know, somebody, for those who don't know, I mean, she was blind and deaf and dumb, and she managed to graduate from college and write books and do all these things. So that's the power of optimism. And as I said, people think, well, why, you know, this guy's writing a book about that, but I really believe in optimism. Mm-hmm. And even if you're cynical about optimism, it works a lot better. For example, I was in the investment business and there's a million guys who tell you how bad things are. I remember when I got in, it was after a terrible bear market, and there were all of these brokers. I'll never buy any stocks, only buy bonds for people. Stocks never go up. And it was right at the beginning of the biggest bull market in history. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the other guys I worked with said, always be, find something to be positive about. Find something that, you know, that's going to change the world. Mm-hmm. Microsoft changed the world. That was a pretty good stock to own. Mm-hmm. You made like 1,000 times your money on Microsoft. Mm-hmm. Apple. I had one client when he died was up 40,000% in Apple. Mm-hmm. That's a lot better. I don't know any bonds that were up 40,000.
No, they're single digit.
Or down.
Yep.
Yeah. So even if you had to force yourself to be optimistic, it in the stock market, it works out for you long.
Yes. And one thing also, you know, when you're talking about the news recently in golf, and maybe I'll get your take on this as well, because there's some optimism that probably needs to come out of that, was the emergence of, you know, the Saudi Arabian Golf League and, of course, you know, the PGA here in the United States. What's going to come from that? What ultimately is going to come from those two merging like that? You're an optimist. Well, but what's the optimistic view of these two?
In the first part of my book, I call the Live Tour the evil 9-hole boombox league. So you can tell I don't like it very much. Mm-hmm. Well, this is kind of reverse optimism, but I think the Saudis are over. You know, let's cut through all the bull.
Right.
The Saudis bought the PGA Tour.
Yeah. All of it.
Yeah. They bought it. They, you know, they can say, they can cloak it with any other. They use their money to buy the PGA Tour. My optimism is they paid way too much. Mm-hmm. It's going to ultimately be a bad investment for them. If you're as old as me, you may remember the Saudis bought a lot of farmland in the United States in the 1980s when they were making all this money in oil, when the oil really went crazy. Mm-hmm. They didn't had so much money. They didn't know what to do with it. They bought a lot of farmland and they lost money on it. Mm-hmm. They top ticked it, as we used to say in the business. It was like buying Yahoo in 1999 or Cisco. Cisco's a great company. If you bought it in 1999, you're not even yet. Mm-hmm. You've lost money if you bought it in 1999, and the earnings have gone way up since 1999. Right. Mm-hmm. If you bought it in 1999, you just paid too much. I think the Saudis paid way too much for the PGA Tour, and ultimately, they're not going to be happy with it. if you look at the demographics of golf, mm-hmm. it's old guys. Millennials aren't playing golf. There's 6% less golf courses than there were in the United States in, mm-hmm. in, 20 years ago. And, you know, you can have boom boxes and stuff. It's still mm-hmm. golf. By the time mm-hmm. when they tee off, it's they can wear short pants and, you know, you're not going to turn golf into TikTok. So no. I think they pay too much and they're going to end up with egg on their face. And we'll probably get back to regular golf after a while. When I heard the news, I thought it was a hoax. Because if you mm-hmm. saw what the PGA commissioner had said about the Saudis, and all of a sudden now
previously, people previously to that. Yeah, because
I don't want to get all political, but I mean, he made some unequivocal statements about them.
Right.
And then to just turn around 180 degrees and mm-hmm. also hang your guys off the dry. If you take Tiger Woods or Rory, these guys turned down hundreds of millions of dollars to go over to the LIV Tour and then he just sold them out.
Yeah.
They were back to where they would have been.
Yeah.
Even if they had taken, you know, Tiger doesn't need the money, but he could have made $800 million.
Right.
And Rory, $400 million. And he just sold it out right for, you pulled the rug right out from under him. That brings you back to the novel I'm writing. It's one of the themes is everybody's got a price. It's what's the number?
Right.
And they obviously hit this guy's number.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, he just forgot all those things he said about 9/11. And,
of course, money talk. So let's talk a little bit about, obviously, what you're doing now. A book is out. It's on Amazon. I had a chance to pick it up. I had a chance to read it. What sort of the marketing are you doing right now? Are you going to be doing libraries with old ladies and puppies again?
I do some talks.
Okay.
Although they're more for my ego than they are to actually sell the books because it's not effective for me. That is not my audience.
Right.
And I start off my talks the same way now. And I tell them a story that's true. Mm-hmm. I met Bill Gates in the late 90s. Mm-hmm. And he was maybe the most famous guy in the world at that point. Just mm-hmm. think about it, the Microsoft. Everybody was waiting for the next release of DOS or whatever it was, of Windows.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I happened to meet him. I was invited to this presentation in New York, mm-hmm. made the presentation. All of a sudden, we're standing in a ballroom. Mm-hmm. Bill Gates is just standing there. Everybody was afraid to go up and talk to him. Mm-hmm. It was like going up to Miss America. Like, what are you going to say?
Right.
So I said, he's just a guy. I'm going to go and introduce myself. Mm-hmm. So I said, hi, I'm Jim. Mm-hmm. He says, Bill. I said, so Bill, what do you do for a living? Well, that's my test because I say to the people at this point, those of you who laughed will probably like my book. Mm-hmm. Those of you who are sitting there with your arms folded thinking, when is this jerk going to stop talking? Probably won't like my book.
Well, I love your books.
And by the way, when I say that, people uncross their arms.
Oh, you're sorry. There's my book.
People uncross their arms.
So I'm not
everybody's cup of tea. Mm-hmm. That's fine. I don't have a problem with that. Don't read my book.
But you got a good following. You've got people like myself that follow your book. I follow you online. I love your postings. When are the next two books coming out? What's the next release date that you're expecting them to be released?
I'm sorry. When is the release date for my novel?
Yeah, for your next two coming out. When are you planning to release those?
Well, the optimism book, I don't know. The novel, I'm planning on September.
September? Okay. Yeah. I'd love to have you back on again when that one comes out. I'm a J.R. Johnson fan as well. I've read, obviously, Bitcoin Gambit and all the books that you've written around it as well. I think it's a great storyline as well. Love your golf books as well. So please keep doing. Please be the optimist. We need people like you in our space.
I tell people who want to be aspiring writers, I say, at least you'll really learn how to type.
Yes.
That's, you know, I figured out I've typed a million words in the last 5 years and I'm really fast typist now. So at least you'll pick up the skill of typing.
Absolutely. And great storytelling as well. Jim, thank you very much for coming on this week's Writers on Writers over at Triple Espresso. Thank you for always coming on and being a great guest as well. Please keep writing. I look forward to the next ones coming out. Love to have you back on again when the book gets released, particularly if it's a J.R. Johnson book. I'm definitely looking forward to that.
J.R.'s next. Thanks, Patrick. Thanks a million for having me. It's always a pleasure.
You too, sir. Thank you, everyone, this week for making on Writers and Writers over at Triple Espresso. This is your host, Patrick Greenwood. We will be on next week. Take care and be safe.